Pleasant good night to each and every one of you. I greet you in the wonderful and the powerful name of our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It is truly a joy and a privilege to be with you on this Tuesday night so that we can study the Word of God and we can worship the Lord together. Hallelujah. Amen. So, could you just bow your heads with me as we look to the Lord and pray? Heavenly Father, eternal and righteous God, we come before you in no other name but the name of our Savior, our Lord and King. And we thank you, O Lord God, for such a privilege and an opportunity like this, that we can come, O God, and assemble together to worship and to honor you, O Lord. There isn't anything more important to us than to worship you, O God. Lord, we thank you for your bountiful blessings, and we thank you, God, for your provision and your protection, O God. But most importantly, O God, we thank you for the privilege to praise you, to worship you, and to fellowship with you, O God. And so tonight, as we sing and rejoice in your presence, I pray, O God, that our worship will ascend unto you as a sweet fragrance. Lord, as an offering, as a sacrifice. Lord, I pray, O God, that you will help us. Father, that our worship will be meaningful, as your word says. I pray, God, that you will give us wisdom and give us understanding in your word. I pray, Father, that we will, Lord, receive insight. May your Holy Spirit teach us tonight. This we ask in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, good night to each and every one of you again, and I welcome each and every one of you. Those of you who have joined us recently, we thank you for being with us. And I also want to encourage you to text somebody or call them, invite them, share the link with them so that they too can join us and be a part of what's happening. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let us join the worshipers as they lead us in a time of celebration and rejoicing in the presence of Almighty God.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise. Sing praise. With a mighty hand. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. His love endures forever. Forever sing praise. That's all we're singing.
His love endures forever. His love endures forever. His love endures forever.
One more time.
His love endures forever.
Sing praise.
Devoted to you, and oh, our Lord, now and forever. It's more than a song. My one desire is to be with you, is to be with you, Jesus, Jesus, oh, Jesus, yeah, Jesus. There's one thing I ask is to be with you.
Welcome back, and we do thank you for joining us and worshiping together. I trust that you have worshipped. You know, I am so that your neighbors heard you worshiping. Hallelujah. We must be free to worship the Lord in every situation. Amen. Praise God. And so tonight I thank God for this privilege so that we can join together to worship and magnify the Lord. Hallelujah. Okay, so tonight we are continuing to talk about the blessings of being in Christ, and I want to touch on a subject that I know that might be controversial to many people, but it is important, and it's imperative that we understand the Word of God and understand it in the context of which it was given. So tonight I want to look at a passage of scripture from Ephesians chapter 1, and I want to begin at verse 3. Ephesians chapter 1, it says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ." Now, I'm going to continue with the other verses, but you know, from you know, I'll probably like do verse by verse, because I don't want to skip and I don't want to miss what the scripture is saying. So in this passage of scripture, we see the word blessed mentioned three times, bless and blessing. It said, "Blessed be the Father, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who had blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. Now, I think I did something a while ago where I talked about blessed, what it means when we talk about being blessed. Like sometime we may greet somebody and say, God bless you. And what does that mean when we shake somebody's hand and say, God bless you? What does it mean? And, you know, then we say, bless God. What does that mean? And so, when we use blessed in terms of God bless you, it means that we are actually talking about favor, or the favor of God coming upon the individual. When we say bless God, we are actually talking about giving praise or honor, giving worship unto Almighty God. So, the first instance is that the first blessed, it is to thank or to invoke a benediction upon someone or to prosper them. It is an act of worship unto Almighty God. So since we cannot give God anything tangible that will enhance his life, since we cannot give him material things that will make him more God, what we do is shower him with praise and adoration. So when we say, blessed be God, it is to invoke praise or adoration unto him. Blessed be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us. He has bestowed upon us and given us blessings that we receive. We receive tangible blessings. We receive material, physical, financial blessings. We receive things from God, and so we are blessed. So, blessed be the God and Father, which means we praise and adore the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who have blessed us in terms, in turn, he has given us things that makes us happy or enhances our lives. You see, I don't want us to go further into this or away from what we are talking, but often when the Bible talks about blessed, it talks about curse. And a blessing is something that we receive from God that enhances our life. A curse is something that we receive that destroys our lives. So there is a difference there. But when we talk about blessings from God, we are talking about God providing for us. And then the third thing is that he has given us all spiritual blessings. In other words, he has given us prosperity. He confers benefits upon us. So when it talks about blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who had blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, it is talking about who God is and what he does. We give him praise for who he is, and then he has chosen to give us things that enhances our lives. And then the third thing is, He have blessed us in heavenly places. Now, I looked up the word, and it literally means above the skies. So God have blessed us with every spiritual blessing that have in the heavenly places in Christ. So let's look at the scripture in the context. Now that we understand what blessing is, a blessing is something that enhances our lives. And I talk about receiving physical blessings to help us understand what it means to be blessed. But in this scripture, it is not necessarily talking about receiving material blessings. It says that God has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. Now, we know that that is not talking about material things. It is spiritual blessings. So what are these spiritual blessings? Right? And that spiritual blessing is not even here. It is in heavenly places, in Christ Jesus. Now, before I go further, I want to point out that there is no blessing outside of Christ. The Bible tells us that every good and perfect gift comes from God. It comes from the Father of lives. So there isn't anything that we can get on our own, anything that we can deserve on our own, or anything that we can conjure up on our own. Our blessing comes from God, and He has blessed us in Christ Jesus. He has blessed us with spiritual blessings. Now, what are these spiritual blessings? I cannot identify, you know, each and every spiritual blessing, but spiritual blessings that God has bestowed upon us is things like giving us insight, giving us wisdom, giving us vision, you know, giving us things that is not tangible and material. And He has blessed us in heavenly places, which means above the skies. So these blessings, though we get it now, it's not a blessing that somebody can snatch away from us. You see, when you get a physical blessing, somebody can snatch that and steal that away from you. But a spiritual blessing is something that man cannot touch, man cannot reach, man cannot conceive. It's a blessing that God have given to you that nobody else knows, nobody else can conceive or perceive what God has given to you. And so, you know, I'm speaking on Sunday mornings in church about being led of the Spirit, and some of these things are intertwined in those messages. But when the Spirit of the Lord leads us, He leads us in areas that is not of this world. He may lead us in this world, but not of the world. And so things like vision and wisdom and you know, those things comes to mind when we talk about being led by the Spirit of the Lord. I see. So God have blessed us with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And I don't want to go too much into it because Sunday morning I'll be covering some of these things. But God wants to give us insight. He wants to give us wisdom. He wants to take us in a dimension that we have not been before, a dimension that is out of this world. And if you read the Bible, you would read the apostles, they did a lot of miracles and perform a lot of miracles right here on earth. But where did they receive that? They received that outside of this world. Flesh and blood didn't give it to them. Their natural mind could not conceive it. Their natural mind could not understand or even receive what God was giving to them. God took them in a dimension that is above this world. And so God gave them things that the mind, the natural finite mind, cannot understand. The apostle writing, he said, I knew a man once, whether it was in the third heaven, the fourth, what I don't know, but I heard unspeakable things that I've never heard before. See? Why? Because God took him in a dimension that is out of this world so that he could receive blessings that is out of this world. And beloved, I want to tell you that God wants to bless you. He wants to give you things that is beyond this world, beyond the norm. He wants to give you insight that is beyond this natural world. And I pray that you will understand that God has already done it. It's not that it's going to be done. He has already made provision for it. It's up to you and I to tap into that. You know, it's just like everything else. Healing is provided for you. Financial blessing and prosperity is provided for you. But it's up to you to tap into that. See? So God has made the way possible. He has paved the way for you and I. And the reason that we are not there is because we have not ventured in to find out what it is God has provided for us. We have to seek wisdom. We can't just sit down, you know, idle and expect wisdom to just fall on our laps. No. We have to seek wisdom. We have to pursue it. We have to seek knowledge. We have to seek understanding. And these are the things that will help us in this natural world. We study books. We gain knowledge. We study a craft. We study a trade. We go to school. We go to university. And all of that is great. And I encourage people to pursue their education in that respect. But let me tell you, there is an education that we need to pursue that is beyond what man can give us. It's an education that comes from God. It's a knowledge that comes from God. It's a knowledge that our mind cannot conceive. And let me tell you, God has already provided that. Now, verse 4 says, just as he has chosen us in him, he has chosen us in him. Who him? In Christ. Remember, everything is in Christ. Outside of Christ, there's nothing for you and I. everything that we can receive is in him and through him. And the Bible says that he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. He has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. Now, let's look at the word chosen. Chosen, it means to choose out, to select. It has the idea of making a choice or selection among different objects or things. I want you to bear this in mind again. When the Bible says that God have chose us long before the foundation of the world, meaning long before you were even born, God chose you. What does it mean that he chose you? The word, it means to make a choice or a selection among different objects. So God didn't choose you because you alone was there. God chose you, handpicked you among so many others. Now, this might sound a little bit like if God is biased, but it isn't. You see, because if we take this in the context of which I'm giving it here tonight, it might sound as if God is biased. That is not so. Because it sounds like it is contradicting the Bible that says, for God so loved this world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now, God did what he did for all of mankind. But you see, we have to understand God as God. God in his sovereignty and in his wisdom sees the past, the present, and the future all in one. So long before you came on the scene, God saw you and he knew what you would do. So the choosing, when we say God chose you, God chose you based on his foreknowledge of your response. See, here is a question that is often asked. Pastor, why God chose me and not my brother, or not my sister, not my sibling, not my parents? Why God chose me? It is because God knew how you would respond to the preaching of the gospel. I am sure your sibling must have heard the word just like you did. I am sure your parents must have heard the word of God just like you did. But did they make a choice? Well, yes, they made a choice. They choose to stay in their religion, or they choose to stay in whatever it is they're in. But you, on the other hand, you responded to the gospel. And therefore, because of that, we can say that God chose you among all of them. Because when I think about it, I often ask myself this question, why God chose me? Am I so special? Am I that good? And I realize from the scripture that it has nothing to do with my goodness. It has nothing to do with my speciality. It has to do with the fact that I respond to the gospel. Because I know my siblings heard the gospel just like I did. I know they heard about the preaching of the gospel just like I did. I remember my brother used to make fun of the preachers and them. I know that he used to go by the church. I know he used to go to the crusades. See? But the difference between him and I was that when I heard the gospel, I responded to the gospel. He did not. He died and ended up in hell, I suppose. Now, that was a hard thing for me to say, but that's the reality of it. But God handpicked me. I mean, when I think of my family alone, right? My parents, 10 children. And out of all of them, I'm the only one. And you know, sometimes we would look at that and say, well, you know, it's because I'm special. It has nothing to do with me at all. It has to do with God making the choice and I responding to that choice. God making the choice for your siblings or my siblings is the same choice that he made for me. But what happened is that I responded to that choice. They didn't. And that's the difference. So long before the foundation of the world, God made a choice. And he chose us among other people. It wasn't just me alone. You don't choose something where it's just one thing. You choose when there are others. You know, it's kind of like me having to make a decision where food is concerned. Sometimes my wife will ask, what do you want to eat? Well, you know, I don't know. I can't decide because it's hard. It's difficult for me to make a choice. So you want fried pork, you want curry, you want stew, you want chicken, you want fish, you want, and there's so much things to choose. It's difficult. And the simplest answer that I could give is anything. And I know it drives her crazy at times, you know, but it's hard for me to make a choice when there's so many things. But, you know, if it's just bygone and roti, you want bygone and roti? Sure. It's just bygone and roti. I don't have to make a choice. And so when we think of God choosing us, we think of it in the context of so many people. Yet God chose us before the foundation of the world. He chose us. Hand picked or plucked out. Now, if I had done like my brother or my siblings and rejected God choosing, and I rejected that, where would I have been today? See, but what makes the difference is that I responded to God choosing. And because I responded, God made a choice that benefits me and it benefits other people as well. It's not just me, because God will continue to choose. When we preach the gospel, it's because God have already made a choice, you know. But we have to preach the gospel so that they will hear and respond. That's why it is imperative for you and I to tell somebody that Jesus died for them. He paid the price. He went on the cross, he suffered, bled and died, so that they can be saved. And once we give that word and we enlighten them, the choice is theirs. They can choose to respond or they can walk away, which so many people have done. You either make a choice or you walk away. So, beloved, as I close tonight, we're going to continue this next week because there's so much more that we need to look at. But tonight, I want you to understand that the Bible says that God have blessed us in heavenly places in Christ, and he have chosen us before the foundation of the world. Think about that. Many times we think that, you know, well, because we just happen to be in the right place at the right time, you know, and that's how we got saved. No, God handplucked you long before the foundation of the world. Heavenly Father, eternal and righteous God, we do give thanks and we give praise to you, O God, for your bountiful blessings upon us. We thank you, God, for giving us wisdom and giving us understanding. And I pray, O Lord, that you will help us, my Father, that we will not just think of ourselves and we will not just think about, you know, the time that we have here, but we will think about what you have done. Because what you have done, we couldn't do. God, we thank you that you made a way for us when there seems to be no way. And I pray, Father, that you will help us, that as we continue to walk with you, and we continue, oh God, to be what you have called us to be, help us that we will do everything within our power, everything that is possible, to bring men and women to you. Lord, we give you praise and we give you thanks tonight in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Praise the Lord. I trust that you have been blessed and you have received the word of the Lord tonight. Tonight, just in case you haven't accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior, I want you to know that he is reaching out to you and he's calling you. If only you would respond and say yes, I know that your life will be better. So if you haven't done that before, please do so tonight. Pray this prayer with me. Father, I come before you tonight in no other name but the name of our Savior, our Lord and King. And I ask, O God, that you will help us. I ask, O Father, that you will, Lord, forgive us of our sins. Forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me. Make me pure. Make me holy. Make me what you want me to be. Lord, I surrender to you tonight. And I ask for your forgiveness. In Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. If you have prayed that prayer, I want you to know that Jesus Christ has saved you. You need to follow him. You need to walk with him. Go to church. Read your Bible. Get some help. Connect with somebody. And if you need help, you can connect with me. My phone number is 319-1286. You can find me on WhatsApp with that number as well. So just in case you call and you didn't get me, just WhatsApp me and I will respond to you as soon as possible. All right? So God bless you. Continue to serve the Lord and be faithful to Him. This is Pastor Ralph Ramlochan of the House of Praise New Testament Church of God located in La Fortune, Laramie, saying to you that with Jesus, the sky is the limit. Be blessed. Have a productive week.